everybody, Alex here. Welcome to my Finance and Accounting Education channel. Today we go forward with our REITs presentation. We are going to tackle the real estate investment trust from United Kingdom this time. In the previous episodes we talked about, so we made a list of REITs of interest from three countries in Europe, namely from Germany, from United Kingdom and from France. We have had a pre-valuation, so just a short look into the REITs from Germany already. Today we are going to do United Kingdom, and in the next episode we are going to have France and hopefully the conclusions. So maybe somehow trying to sort them out and see which are more interesting for from each country. There are many criteria to take into consideration. Such an investment is never an easy decision. But before we jump right in, I'm just going to ask you to subscribe to my channel and to hit the bell notification button. You will never miss an update on my site. I do them quite regularly on Tuesdays, Thursdays and Sundays. That being said, let's go right in. So we had the final list of rates which I'm going to consider for these three countries which I mentioned: Germany, France and United Kingdom. Much to my surprise, I have discovered another one which landed on my list initially, namely Rightmove, which is not a real estate investment trust. It was marked as a real estate on the STOXX page. So remember, all these companies are part of the STOXX 600, this index from Europe, which is made out of 600 very important from volume companies in Europe, much like the S&P 500 from the United States. And from this we have selected several companies which were supposed to be real estate or real estate investment trust. Somehow Rightmove from United Kingdom was marked there as a real estate company, but it's not really a real estate. So of course I took that baby out very fast, because this is not we don't have as an objective evaluating companies from other sectors. Once again, I'm just disclosing my sources. So eToro, Google Finance, Yahoo Finance, Rate Comparison, .co.uk, Markets, Financial Times.com, DividendMax.com, and of course the investors relations pages and reports of the respective companies. So this would be the summary of the metrics that I have used. For the final version, so after we also take a look at the four rates from France, I'm going to consider if I'm going to keep all of them, besides the fact that I will have to somehow make them comparable, because the ones from Germany and from France will be in euro, and the ones from the United Kingdom will be in Great British, not pound but actually in pence, so in 100 parts of a pound. I'm going to also have to consider if we are going to keep all the metrics. I already knew and mentioned several times that some of the metrics are not that relevant for the sector, namely the PE ratio. It said that because the companies have a lot of freedom in depreciating their assets, namely the buildings, the earnings are not that relevant, and we should look at something which is similar to EBITDA, let's say, so earnings before interest, tax and depreciation and amortization, which for REITs is called funds from operations or free funds from operation, FFO, which would be more relevant as a proxy to their performance. Also with revenues, I have several doubts, at least for the German ones. I found something which was called result from, so in the investor relation reports and so on from the companies, which was called result from lending or something like that, or from other activities, which to me sounds more like a gross margin. So it's not really a revenue, meaning when you say result, and last time when I checked their Ergebnis in German was result and not revenue, that means that they are already deducting some costs and they are not really comparable with our typical revenue. So maybe I will also take the revenues out. However, what we know for sure, what's relevant is the price in the market, and there is no doubt about that. The market cap is only giving us some information about the size of the business, and of course the bigger the safer it should be. So we are not playing with businesses or with rates under 1 billion euros or Great British Pound, so GBP. Then the dividend yield is should also be quite clear. We know what kind of dividends the companies have paid. I have checked it with multiple sources that they are right, the numbers, and divided by the prices, so we should be okay. We know that the dividend growth from for 2021, so the dividend which will be paid in 2020 is just let's say an estimation made by several analysts. For example, for the UK companies, there were the sources which was from Financial Times, and there you can find average calculated from several analysts and what they expect. So also they should be treated not as an absolute metric, so everything should be regarded with not in terms of as the ultimate metric and the only metric that we take into consideration when we somehow try to figure out which ones are better than the others and so on and so forth. I will see how we will adapt this table, so the metrics maybe will not be the final ones, which I will come up with in the last presentation. Maybe if in the part 4 we will just do France, and then I will take some time to somehow try to come with better or with more relevant metrics here, so with more relevant ratios. We will see. But for the United Kingdom, just one important thing to mention from the start, the prices of the absolute numbers, except okay, the market capitalization is in billions, but the prices which you will see for the quoted all over the place for the United Kingdom shares, or in this case for real investment trusts, we are not in Great British Pounds, but actually they are in pence. So you will have to, in order to see how many Great British Pounds, you'll have to divide by 100. But since we are mostly looking at, let's say, at ratios like P ratio, price to sales ratio, dividend yield, and so on and so forth, let's just say that the absolute amounts are not that relevant. They could have been relevant, for example, for the SEGRO, for the largest one. If you only want to invest £1,000, you could have said that, okay, you don't have enough. Maybe you need only to buy or to find some way of buying some split shares if somebody is offering you that. That's not the case, because those are not £1,274. Those are only £12.74. A word of warning, that was also funny for me to find out, and because I don't own any shares from United Kingdom, I never owned any from what I know, and yeah, so this was also news to me. Also the entire stuff with the real estate investment trusts and what I have said about the earnings not being that relevant, but this FFO, so the funds from operations, and the revenues being actually some sort of gross margin, so some result from renting activity or from other activities and so on and so forth, these are also new to me, and I think I was quite transparent when I said that I never invested in real estate in general, and because I don't intend on the, to acquire an object, so to buy a house or an apartment. The only other alternative for me was investing in this real estate investment trust. And I was quite transparent, and I said that I don't have that much experience, and we are going to learn together about them, and this is what we are doing, and I hope you are okay with that. Now, just jumping right in the list, so after we kicked right move from the list, we remain with this 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9. The largest one from market capitalization is SEGRO with £15.31 billion. The smallest one from this list seems to be primary health properties with only 2 points of actually Assura 1.97. I'm sorry. So anyway, all of them are above 1 billion pounds. Now, from sector's point of view, much to my surprise and completely different than the German rates, they are not that much into housing, so not into residential. So the largest ones from United Kingdom are mostly so industrial. We have here for SEGRO land and securities is retail and commercial. A British land company also commercial retail. Derwent is also commercial. Assura is healthcare. Big Yellow Group is storage. Retail distribution for Londonmetric. Tritax also distribution and primary health properties healthcare. So actually none of them are in housing, so in residential, which is from this point of view it's somehow removing my concerns about affecting some people's life with my investment, let's say. However, there are also downside to this as well. Namely, if you look at the PE ratios of land securities and British land company, that they don't exist, meaning that they had losses in the past year, and which can be easily understood. They were in retail and in commercial, and they didn't quite made it, so they didn't have earnings. So because of the COVID pandemic, quite easy when you own apartments, the people will try to hold their apartments unless they have big troubles with employment and so on and so forth. But the let's say that the tenants from shops and malls and things like this, they might have also have some legal conditions that they no longer need to pay you rent because of the COVID pandemic, and the companies have to swallow the losses somehow and to accept them. And we will see also what was the impact in the price, in the share prices, and how to interpret these things. From PE ratios, let's say Derwent London with 73.51 PE ratio managed to have a low level of earnings, unlike land securities and British land company. In the same time, Assura and primary health properties also with relatively high PE ratios because of lower levels of earnings compared with the others in this list. And then under 10, so under 10 PE ratios, you have all the others of SEGRO, Big Yellow Group, Londonmetric, and Tritax Big Box. Then you have the revenues, which I said that might not be that relevant because maybe they are doing a lot of earnings from having their property revalued and so on and so forth. So also the price to sales ratios in this case will not be that relevant. However, we have dividend yield. Dividend yield, remember what we calculated here is the dividend of the last year against the current price. So the best dividend yield from this list is offered by Assura in healthcare, followed by primary health properties, so also in healthcare. And then you have land securities, which despite not having earnings was able to pay quite a good dividend, 3.88%. And you still have some others above 3. You have Londonmetric Property 342 and British Land Company 303, and some others which are with 2%, 2.18, 2.36 and 2.993 for Derwent, Big Yellow Group and Tritax, and SEGRO, which is offering only 1.73%. And all of them have expectations to have a growing dividend for the 2021 from the analysts. The largest one seems to be by British Land Company, honestly, and also the land security, so the exactly the ones which were hitting the earnings are expected to deliver the highest dividend growth. And to be honest, if they were able to pay such a good dividend despite losses, after the COVID pandemic, if their activity picks up, and they should increase the dividend as well, because probably they are very profitable from this point of view once the restrictions in the market are eliminated. Of course, they are all from the UK, we said that, and the sectors we talked about it. So from these metrics here, you see none of them, it's super fabulous, and none of them is very bad. So let's say that they are acceptable as investments, all of them. But let's see what's in the charts of the price evolution. So one of the few in Germany we had absolutely none in red. We have land securities, which is in red. What's the problem with land securities? The problem is that since 2017, so this chart goes back 5 years, since 2017 the prices were actually going down, stagnating. So they were almost somewhere around 1150 in 2017, and then they steadily dropped, and they never reached 1000 until 2020, and then they dropped because of the pandemic, and they somehow a little bit recovered, but not that much. Let's just say from price point of view, there is the potential to reach again 754, but unless we know exactly what happened here, it doesn't look like a company which is developing or it's performing. We eliminate the pandemic and this big fall here, which is something which happened to many companies, and just to say that I don't like the way things evolved in this graph. I mean, I don't see a good trend, let's say. Also, the price to book ratio is 0.72, which is quite a good one, meaning that for each 72 cents of price, you have or 72 pence, you have £1 in the book value, so in the assets that they hold. A totally different chart has SEGRO, which has delivered the 201% in growth in the past 5 years. Of course, they were also affected by this drop in 2020, maybe not that much as land securities, and then they came back on growth. SEGRO is quite close to the 52 weeks highest, and I think 52 weeks highest might be also, yeah, it's for sure is the highest ever, at least in the last 5 years. So it looks good, but I don't know if it has potential to go farther above 1308, yeah, and has a price to book ratio 1.42, which can also show you that it's a little bit pricey or overpriced, because that means that for each 1.42 pounds you are getting £1 of assets, so of property. Then we have Derwent also a growth, but not that large, 35% in the past 5 years, also affected a little bit later during 2020. So it's very interesting that they took the dip not in March or in April like most of the others. Quite back on the return from the where the price is positioned related to the last 52 weeks, I think it has potential to go back to 3,800. So it should be okay as an investment. You also see it's not spectacular. It's not the 201% increase from SEGRO, but it's still quite an okay company from my point of view. Then we have another one in red. I think it's the last one from this list, which, not surprisingly, has a chart which is identical to land securities. So what was going on before the pandemic, I don't like it that much. So this is the perfect chart which you have for trading, yeah, for buying in the lows and selling when the price goes up again and again and again and again. But for a long-term investment, it doesn't look very good. Also the drop with the pandemic and then some sort of recovery, but not 100%. The 52-week highest is 550. Maybe they have the potential to go up from 487, but for a very long this, if I would buy this, it would be either for trading it, so buying at 487 and then immediately selling it at 500 or things like this, or I would just set, if it would be on a medium term or something like that, I would just set an alarm at 550, and if it's being reached in half an year, in 1 year, so not very very fast, I would probably get out of this investment. It also has a price to book ratio of 0.78, the Derwent also 0.89, so let's say that they are quite safe, meaning that the for £1 invested, so in the price of share, you get more assets. So actually for 0.78 cent invested in the price of the share, you get £1 of assets, and for Derwent you get 18 so for 0.89 cent invested in the share, you get £1 of assets. Then we have Big Yellow Group and Assura. Big Yellow Group also with quite a good growth in the past 5 years, 113. I'm quite sure that's above inflation rate. The dip in 2020, then they recovered, then they slumbered a little bit in September. It's okay, it's happening. September was a crazy month. We talked already in the video. I'm posting the video right now. Yeah, and I think it has the it was the this 1586 seems also to be the highest level ever reached, and I think it probably has the potential to reach it again. So however, from the price to book value, it seems a little bit pricey. So 1.83, you have to pay £1.83 to get £1 of assets in case of Big Yellow Group. Then we have the Assura PLC, because this is in healthcare and there is only one else in healthcare, if I remember correctly. Okay, we didn't got to it. Somehow it's the behavior of Assura is in, and during the pandemic is completely different than the other ones. So it took some sort of dip, but it was not that high, and then it came back, but it's also the price is undecided. Maybe it will go back to 80. Before the pandemic, it was above 80, let's say 83, 84. Price to book ratio 1.29. So, I don't know. Starting from, it was a good stock to buy before 2019, let's say. But starting from 2009, it seems like it's also appropriate for more for trading. I don't know. I don't have a final opinion about it either. Then we have the Londonmetric and Tritax. Tritax Big Box, this is a big box is for storage. Seems to be benefiting from the logistic troubles. Let me just quickly check that it's storage. Yeah, it's storage. Tritax is distribution actually. Big Yellow Group was storage. So Tritax, I took a big dip in 2020 and then it started growing a lot, somehow different than the behavior from before the pandemic. For sure it took in September a dip, maybe it can reach again to 141. Price to book value 1.28, so also a bit pricey from this point of view. Then we have the Londonmetric Property PLC. Londonmetric is once again is retail distribution, so let's say distribution is somehow something which is should work well now. They also took a dip, then they recovered. Okay, the September dip, okay, maybe they can also reach 265. But the potential for growth of 70% in the past 5 years, maybe. I don't know. It's not spectacular, but maybe it has potential to continue, not a very fast growth. And then we have the primary health properties. So the primary health properties should be more or less the same as Assura. Okay, so you see not such a large dip in 2020 and quick recovery, but also after that the performance was not outstanding. Let's say that 1 or 2 months before they reached better levels, so probably this 170. Of course, it was reached here, the peak. Now it's 155, so it has the potential to grow another 15 pence, so 0.15 pounds. And it has a price to book ratio of 1.40, which is also sending it in the more pricey ones. So this would be from the United Kingdom. Remember, everything that I presented to you before this is included in STOXX 600. Others which are not included in STOXX 600, but they are still above 1 billion pounds market capitalization, so quite respectable, are the Unite Group PLC, which it's in student accommodations. This one, I don't know if we are taking into consideration my concerns about the let's say about the social aspects of investing in real estate. Maybe it's not a very good one. Safe Store Holding PLC, Shaftesbury Capital and Counties Properties, Hammerson Great Portland Estates. Yeah, so maybe these are other alternatives you should take a look into. That was it for today. Just as said, next time the France, we only have four from France. I hope I will have no surprises there anymore. And wrap up, I don't know. Maybe we'll do it together with France, and we will talk about FFO and other metrics and which ones are more interesting than the others and things like this. Maybe I will do it separately. I haven't decided yet. However, this Sunday we will talk about the Tesla quarter three results. Tesla continues to grow. There is no surprise there. I'm not so excited about it. I mean, I've found out in the meantime more things. I know why some people are so excited about it. I don't believe in their excitement or the reasons that they are excited about. But we will talk on Sunday more in detail about Tesla. Just remember to subscribe to my channel and to hit the bell notification button. You will never miss an update on my site. To like this video if you liked it. To share it with somebody that you think might be interested, or to comment if you have something to add. It can be pro what I'm presenting here or against. It doesn't really matter. Also below this video you have some links. You can create an eToro account and trade there without a commission or a fee, which is always a saving. You can get 2 free audibles, so audiobooks from Amazon, or you can get into the Kindle program and read electronic books. I also have a Kindle and I'm reading electronic books. And last but not least, there is a wish list with both software and hardware items which can help me improve the quality of my videos, and it will also be very beneficial for you. But it's the most inconvenient for you from the financial perspective. The easiest way through which you can support me is, of course, to subscribe to my channel and to keep watching my videos. Once again, my name is Alex Petrescu. Thank you for watching me today, and I look forward to presenting to you next time. Goodbye!